What's up, guys? I'm the Pop Rocker, and I apologize if I'm a little off this week. I am feeling a bit under the weather, but it is officially next Friday night, so I've got to get this show rolling one way or another. Let's get started. ABBA, Voyage. Oh, ABBA, how we thought we missed you. Now, I heard the couple of singles that were released a few months ago, so I wasn't expecting Mamma Mia, but man, did you know that the band is Swedish? Because it seems like they really want you to know this time. Gone are the slamming hits of yesteryear, and instead we've been given what sounds like contemporary takes on old folk songs. The most true to form and probably best song on the album, in my opinion, is Keep an Eye on Dan, which is really just a song about a mother asking someone to watch their child who can be a handful. But it's set over this dark synth beat that seems to be setting it up to be the hit that the 80s forgot until it falls flat as well. Really, I think every song ends up being ruined by their lyrics. They're like the type that would come out of a viral YouTube video from 2008 that was recorded in a mall or something. I never really got deep into ABBA's discography, so maybe this doesn't come as much of a shock to some people, but these songs would never have been turned into a musical. Would I recommend it? No, I would not. James Arthur. It'll all make sense in the end. James Arthur impressed the world, myself included, with the hit song Say You Won't Let Go a few years back. Enough so that I've ridden with him through two albums that didn't really end up impressing me that much. So I decided with this one, it either needs to be a hit or this is the end of the road for us. And I can report that James Arthur has managed to keep me on the hook for one more album to see how it goes from there. This album may be his best to date, but I'm not really sure how to read it. It's like a weird blend of singer-songwriter standards and pop instrumentals that don't really fit the brand. Like an album full of dance tracks featuring a pop artist. You know the ones, cough cough Zed. But underneath the thinnest layer of insincerity is like an honest and real collection of thoughts and feelings. Like, this is just a good album that's been brought down to be a tolerable album. Would I recommend it? Maybe just put it on in the background and see if it grabs you. Aminé, 2.5. This album is all about perspective. If you take it at face value or cherry pick any of the songs out, it sounds like it's just music made to get big on TikTok, especially the big hit, Charmander. But if you put the whole album on at once, it's an audio soundscape that's really fun to get lost in. I'm not going to say it's entirely original because it sounds like the kind of thing that exists five times over out there, but I'll say if it does, it's still a more enjoyable copy of something else than most. Would I recommend it? Sure. Keto, Blossom. I'm not even going to beat around the bush here. This is one of the most generic and derivative pop albums that you'll hear this year. 100%. Every song is unoriginal. Is it good? Yeah, it's good for generic pop music, but it's really just useless noise at a certain point. Would I recommend it? What's the point? Diana Ross, Thank You. What do I think of this album? I mean, it's Diana Ross, so... Ross returns with her first album in over two decades. And you would think with a title like Thank You, it would just be a whole career retrospective. But instead, it's an insanely positive collection of hits meant to inspire joy and change. And I'll be honest, even being Diana Ross, they aren't all hits. The song Let's Do It, which is very much not what you think it is, isn't really the best song. And at a certain point on the album, it feels like she's just making interpolations of the same positive songs. But she still manages to satiate her core fan base, and at the end of the day, isn't that what really matters? Would I recommend it? I mean, it's Diana Ross, so... Terrace Martin, Drones. Sometimes it's jazz, sometimes it's rap, sometimes it's R&B. This is one of those albums where the instrumentation and songwriting are too high a level for me to properly review, because they're better than anything I could really put into words. Every track feels like its own art piece, and I do mean every track. The quality never goes down. Even in the interludes, even the song that's just a slam poem, they all have the same flavor. If I haven't sold you yet, let me put it this way. This is the album that can feature Kendrick Lamar and Ty Dolla $ign on the opening track, and by the end of the album, you've forgotten that even happened because it was just one of the many songs you heard. Would I recommend it? It's a little bit weird, but it's alright. Nathaniel Rateliff and the Night Sweats. The Future. Ah, Nathaniel Rateliff. The next defining musical artist of one of the four male archetypes. Now, I can't say I've ever listened to one of his albums all the way through because I am not that male archetype, so I figured I'd give it a shot. And I've got to say, I wasn't disappointed. Americana as a genre has been dying off steadily since the 70s, but it really gained a little bit of a spark in the last decade, and Rateliff is one of the artists who helped make that happen. But this album doesn't really feel like it has that rebirthing spark in it. Now, that's not to say it's a bad thing at all. This is probably the Americana album of the year. It's still got all that classic folk blood in it with a little bit of modern Black Keys vibe going on. It just doesn't seem like the thing that's going to draw new people into it. Would I recommend it? To everyone who would want it. Snail Mail. Valentine. This is an album that I hate to say wasn't my favorite, and I hate it because I don't think it was Snail Mail's fault at all. Valentine is an indie rock spectacle that has probably captured the hearts and minds of many people over the last week. It's an intimate and relatable collection of songs that brings about that jaded mindset towards relationships and heartbreak that a lot of us have started to feel around that younger age. And the sound isn't really that bad at all either. Honestly, I feel like with another album or two, Snail Mail could be the next 1975 in terms of stardom, which is why it pains me to say that this album just fell a little bit short of the mark for me, especially compared to the last one. But I have to be honest. Would I recommend it? Probably, but not quickly. William Black, Pieces. I see so many electronic and dance albums when I'm doing my music thrifting, and it's always just the same Euroclub dance beat music. So when I get a chance to review something that really does catch my ear in the genre, it's exciting. So I can see the irony when I come here and report that this album is just generic dance music. It's just a different type of generic. It's a rush of female voice songs that go through the verse and pre-chorus before hitting the drop with a synth melody that's usually just a retake on the pre-chorus vocals. You know, like the kind that free-use background music streamers use. Or the thing that sounds exactly like this. You know what I'm talking about. This is another one of those take that how you want situations. None of the music is bad, it's just generic and kind of bland. And I mean that in the least mean way possible. Would I recommend it? Only as background music. Dijon. Absolutely. So I was reading up on this album and I read that it was like some form of collaborative process with an open studio and people could just come and go as they please. And off the bat, can I just say that that sounds like the funnest thing ever? Just an open environment where you and your friends can have fun and explore music and keep record of it. As a review though, I feel like this is kind of necessary knowledge. Like, the album's cool on its own, but with this secret unlocked, it's so much more in focus. Like, the disjointed nature of the instrumentation and the open, loose feeling of everything, like it's being recorded in a lived-in house, because I guess it basically was. It takes the album from being just an artistic creation and reframes it as a moment in time, an experiment in music and expression that frankly is just straight up beautiful. Would I recommend it? Now that you have the knowledge that I did, I highly encourage you to go give it a chance. Serena Isioma, Crying in the Club. First off, let me make clear that this is a very short EP, clocking in at just over 10 minutes. Second off, let me make clear that every one of those 10 minutes is wonderful. Part soul, part jazz, part French pop. I had to listen to this EP twice before I would even let myself write about it. This doesn't even really feel like an EP as much as a teaser for an artist that I'm very excited to hear more from. Isioma has found a very clever way to express themselves and I can't wait to see what comes next from them. It doesn't feel quite right making this my pick of the week because it's such a small piece, but it's my show and nothing else compares, so it's my pick of the week. Would I recommend it? There's literally no reason not to listen to it. And that's finally going to do it for this week's Weekly Music Hall. Thank you, as always, guys, for watching and listening. If there's any music you think I missed out on last week, please let me know down in the comments. If there's something you don't want me to miss out on this week, you can find my socials in the description. Send me a link. I'd love to check it out for you. As always, if you like what you see, like, share, subscribe, you know the drill. But most importantly, tell your friends. And until next week, I've been the Pop Rocker, and I'll see you guys in the next video.